Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Legend of the Albino Farm by Steve Yates, narrated by Nina Alvamar. Chapter 1. On the northern border of Springfield, Missouri, there was once a great house surrounded by emerald woods, lake, and meadow, a home place and farm that, to the lasting sorrow of its owners and heirs, acquired a nonsensical legend marring all memory of its glory days. The estate became known, and is still known, if it is remembered at all, as the Albino Farm. The legend, which began to circulate in town just after the Second World War, had no basis in anything like the truth. Albinos did not live on the farm, never had. They certainly were never tortured there. No one ever was. And who in their right mind would hire an albino for a caretaker? A vast Irish Catholic family, the Sheehys, farmed on 330 acres and lived there in that 13-room mansion across the highway from Green Hills Cemetery. If they seemed pale, it was in the winter months. They were, even the women, strikingly tall, all with long faces. Aloof, better than the rest of Springfield. And strange. It was Hettienne that the Sheehys worried most about. The young girl had been vigorous, giddy, with fine and flowing blonde hair, and a penchant for any game that involved running and screaming. But when she turned 13, she suffered episodes of catatonia, somnambulism, and jags of mystifying talk. Lost in these fits, Hettienne saw what was coming for her family. A chaos, a curse, the legend that would haunt her for the rest of her life. On the train with her parents in 1946, traveling down from Chicago for their annual summer visit to the old Sheehy place, she fretted. Beneath the tan sunlight lancing through the narrow windows, something was breaking open. She could sense it, like the rupture of peeling skin beneath which shone startling white flesh. This trip, her legs cramped against tabletops. When she extended them, they jutted like two monstrous icicles. As the dining car banged across trestles above the sparkling Osage River, a woman tottered around her with newspapers rolled under each arm and steaming coffee sloshing. "Sit up straight," her father whispered. "Hettienne." John Sheehy paused and gave the apologetic traveler the flat hint of a smile, his lips tight as a stitch. "Hettienne," he resumed once the woman passed. "You may very well be the last Sheehy." Simon Sheehy ran the farm and household, and sticking with tradition, all of Simon's 9 nieces and nephews, 8 Ormonds and the one Sheehy child, Hettienne, returned to the 13-room sprawl of the farmhouse every summer. Maybe the trip exhausted her. But on the feast day of St. Malmura O'Garmon, amid preparations for fireworks at the lake and plates of food streaming from the kitchen, Hettienne lost all connection with the joy and bustle around her. At dinner, her eyes capsized into a void. She stared so long at cousin Liliana Ormond that the toddler plunked her cornbread into her milk bowl, pointed, then wailed. When Hettienne did not relent, the toddler grew hysterical. The rest of the dinner table hushed. Bolting up like flushed quail, Agnes, Margaret, and Helen, the 3 spinster Sheehy aunts, murmured urgently. Simon stepped behind Hettienne and placed both of his broad, knotted hands on her shoulders, all stilled along the dining table, down to the least Ormond cousin.
"All of you up. Help Agnes clear," Simon said. "Dinner has ended. Children are excused."
Wide-eyed, they cleared. Aunts whispering sharp instructions, frantic cousins slipping away to hide and watch. At last it was just Simon, her Uncle James, and her father and mother there with Hettienne, the alarmed adult standing, the teen seated. How small her mother Charlotte seemed, dwarfed by red-headed Sheehy men. Behind them, casement windows flooded the dining hall with a green, swirling light.
"Child," said Simon, "tell me that you know where you are."
The whole dining hall, often gloomy, as if its high ceiling were swallowed in a fog, glowed. Then all became a dazzling white, and she heard herself droning low. "Up the airy mountain, down the rushing glen, we daren't go a-huntin' for fear of little men." At the table, decorated with its red, white, and blue tablecloth, for a long time the only sound was the simmering hiss of the wind passing through three willows that sheltered the house.
"She,"
Simon whispered.
"You have taught her the old legends, John?"
he asked, his voice hinting at approval, one hand now stroking the poor girl's head. Blonde straight hair from her mother, the first Sheehy ever to carry such a head of hair.
"I don't know what she means. It's 1946. I'm not trying to make her more Irish."
Simon frowned.
"She's read the poem somewhere, then."
"She's a very popular girl at Our Lady of the Angels," her mother inserted. "No time for silly, blaspheming books. Tell your uncle, Hettienne." When Hettienne did not answer, her father stepped forward and held a hand out to her. She took it and rose from her chair.
"She has been speaking in rhymes lately, losing her concentration, daydreaming."
Turning, he pointed at her mother.
"Once we are back in Chicago, Mother will get her to a doctor."
Chapter 2. That Hettienne could post to the correct diagonal so naturally in her stirrups and ride better and longer than any of her rural cousins was a constant source of chafing to them, especially considering Hettienne was from the great big city of Chicago. And even today, despite all this strangeness at dinner, Simon announced Hettienne was to ride the testy black colt, Questa Volta, the only thoroughbred on the farm. Though the cousins observed an instructive moment between Simon and Hettienne at the mounting stone, it was conducted in a whisper. She leaned into him, holding back all that yellow hair, which ought to have been braided or rolled up in a bun under a pinned hat. Instead, she wore it loose beneath a man's hooligan driving cap twisted backward. In her white and flawless skin, in the hint of muscle at her shoulders and forearms, and her sure movements, round Ormond cousins could project and already envy a stunning tall woman soon to be. She wore such citified riding gear, a white blouse, a tweed blazer, brown leather boots to mid-calf with hardly a crack. That long face, those icy blue Sheehy eyes. Simon gripped Hettienne's knee with a steady confidence. Cousin Johanna, who rode side saddle and tortured her poor old Morgan with all her extra pounds, marshaled her young Ormond sisters around her. The vast stone stable smelled of biting limestone, cedarwood, and last autumn's hay.
"What if one of us throwed that fit? To be born a Sheehy,"
Johanna griped. The Ormond girls then all clamored for a leisurely ride to the lake, while Cousin Johanna offered to recite the tale of Princess Emily and the Moan of Palamon. But damned if rather than a trot around the lake and waterfall, Simon and Hettienne headed the riding party straight for the oval racetrack. On the dirt track, Simon, riding an old chestnut gelding, ordered Cousin David, on a young black filly, out across from him with a rope stretched between them. Far off at the start of the home stretch, Hettienne warmed up Questa Volta. The Ormond ladies groused in a knot. In Simon's hand, the silver of the stopwatch gleamed. At Simon's nod, Cousin Hal dismounted and cupped his hand around the bell's breast-like orb then pulled the lanyard to test its muted clapper. Brrrrup! Simon nodded. Hooking two fingers at his lips, he let tear a hunter's whistle. Then he waved his hat to Hettienne and circled it around his head. Hettienne pranced to them on Questa Volta.
David, Hal,
Simon said, as Questa Volta approached the taut rope, which now became a starting line across the dirt track. The colt was so muscled that watching his hide move was like staring at the transformations in the raw charcoal of beams raised by fire. When the black colt steadied behind the rope, Simon raised the silver stopwatch. With a click of his thumb, he brought the watch down in a silver flash. Hal pulled the bell. Simon and David dropped the rope. At the rip of the bell, Questa Volta lunged. In no time, the colt and Hettienne were full out, shooting toward the first turn, then shrinking to a distant dust boil along the backside of the dirt oval, hand riding, the horse taking all the ground it wanted. Straightening in the home stretch, she coaxed, and Questa Volta switched leads without any hauling. David's and Hal's faces both went blank. The Ormond girls all sullenly tucked their chins to their collarbones. Simon straightened his shoulders, and in that moment seemed to shed decades. In her hand, the riding crop flashed. She showed it to the colt, popped it once hard to Questa Volta's black rump. Then suddenly, as she brought the crop forward and back to snap the leather with all the volume but none of the sting, a slip, a scramble, and the crop tumbled to the ground. All gasped but Johanna, and she braced up her posture and smugly waited for the worst to unfold. Yet Hettienne crouched and urged with the horse, rocking, elbows sometimes up around its ears. The reins flourished as if she might cast them like ribbons of lightning. The horse, crop or not, found its second gear, blowing. Ears forward. Simon raised the watch high. The colt stretched nose, neck, and then Hettienne crossed the finish line. Clasped with the colt's back, she rode her arms onward again. The colt seemed not to touch the dirt, but floated. Though they all knew the vision impossible from the pounding of hooves, there it floated, a black streak, a white rider flashing by. Simon consulted the watch while Hal and David eyed him in wonder. Simon scowled at them, then coldly scanned the Ormond girls fanning themselves at the rail.
Now that, Simon said to all, is a Sheehy.
Standing to her full height in the stirrups, Hettienne rode Questa Volta to them, jouncing sideways as if the all-out run on the farm's only thoroughbred had been no effort at all. Though everyone scoured the dirt track for the bobbled riding crop, the heat forced their surrender and withdrawal, and its loss was but a minor disappointment. Riding back to the stable alongside his Sheehy niece, Simon told her and the Ormonds the tale of the sick bed of Cuculain, and how Sheehy ancestors at combat tournaments sang ballads of all the foes they had slaughtered and claimed proof of each victory by cutting off the tip of a bested opponent's tongue. From a leather pouch strung around the neck of a Sheehy warrior, these bits of gristle were brandished at high points during a triumphant song, the legends of the vanquished clearly the property of the victor. As Simon went on, Hettienne slowed Questa Volta to ride beside glum Johanna. She leaned to Johanna with a wink. How's that for a tale of yore, cuz? Never yet bested, Johanna stuck out her tongue. Then, from behind her back, she brought Hettienne's dusty riding crop. She wobbled it. Drop something, cuz? After hot walking and washing the colt with Hettienne, Simon ordered his dearest niece to minister the white analgesic liniment, Roy Boy. This she did with the care and drama of an acolyte at an altar, despite the nervous eyes of the Hungarian groom and the riveted focus of Simon. The two men monitored the girl's long arms and graceful fingers, dipping into the crock of Roy Boy and salving the thoroughbred's legs white. The colt gave only a shiver and a stamp. Johanna, smoldering, turned away to walk her horse to the stables alone. Chapter 3. In the dead of night, Aunt Agnes found Hettienne in a chemise and boxers standing before the open icebox, arms dripping wet, mouth agape, and eyes like saucers. Puddles of water trembled around the child's bare feet. Agnes called the girl's full name, Hettienne Ellery Sheehy. No reaction. A still white streak in the musty dark of the kitchen ell. Agnes spat upon the floorboards at her niece's bare feet, then made the sign of the cross. The instant she finished with the Holy Spirit, she clutched her dressing gown up at her hips and rushed to fetch James, her heart as frantic as a sparrow in a fist. James had studied sleepwalking and had, in fact, brought Simon to safety many times. "Oh, hell," said James in a whisper on seeing his niece. Agnes released his hand, then smacked his knuckles. "Remember," James whispered, "the pain of growing that fast?" Agnes's lips puckered.
"I remember the switch. My back'll soon remember the mop and bucket."
"Tell no one," James said, then held his finger to his lips for a long while to be clear. "Last thing we want's for her mother to fly into a rage and take her forever from us."
"Bitch," spit Agnes.
"Yes, but the girl's mother as well."
Hettienne did not come down to family breakfast, a breach unless gravely ill. Young Ormond cousins whispered and wondered. Johanna smarted most from this unprecedented privilege, and became so wound up that David at last asked,
"How do you know she isn't ill, heifer?"
The Ormond children landed at the table in a foul mood. Agnes was in a muddle, dropping plates, leaving milk to scald at the back of the stove. Simon kept an eye on them all, tense and silent.
"A memorable breakfast," Helen Sheehy remarked once the spinsters were shut in the kitchen. "For unknown reasons."
With the meal cleared, the three spinster sisters were nibbling and gossiping in the kitchen amid the leftovers and dirty dishes when Hettienne entered from the back ell, dressed for riding, her hat in her hand and her hair woven in a bun, of which all three spinsters instantly approved.
"I'll be direct," snapped Margaret Sheehy.
Helen and Agnes moved an echelon behind her. In their long brown dresses, they appeared to Hettienne as human approximations of the round-bodied, drab female widgeons bustling on Lake Michigan.
"Just what is the meaning of all this, young lady?"
Hettienne bowed her head, but could not stop the emotion flooding her.
"I love you all so very much," she whispered, her voice quaking.
For all her summers, all the blazing months away from Chicago in the paradise of the Sheehy farm among family, she had been their infallible favorite, the one Sheehy child. She knew her episodes made for a confusing, alarming disappointment.
"I'm so sorry to have caused all this trouble."
She covered her face with her hands. The kitchen smelled of live yeast, flour, bacon, peppery sausage gravy, and cantaloupe. Hettienne cupped all those soothing smells to her. Like a flock, the three sisters nestled forward, and their long arms swooped around her shoulders and waist. She let them lower her hands, and Margaret then lifted Hettienne's chin.
"Oh, dear child, we sisters agree. This staring, this rhyming, the gaps, it is just manifestations of the change."
Her voice dropped to a low whisper.
"From girl to woman, Sheehys change hard."
The spinsters all nodded.
"Agnes, I swear, sent the moon awry," said Aunt Helen.
Not at all ready for the circle into which she had just been admitted, Hettienne shuddered. I'm hungry, she managed. Lightning fast, fried potatoes, sausage, milky coffee, and the remains of a pyramid of melon balls, orange, green, and red, flashed before her. The sisters hovered while she ate.
Why's your Uncle James look so dreadful, Hettienne? Margaret asked.
Because, Hettienne realized, he had been up half the night with her. She recalled awakening in the pit of the night, seated on a chair in this kitchen, roasting by the ancient stove which smelled of charred metal. A grill of flickering orange, and there was James kneeling, staring up at her. James had touched Hettienne's shoulder.
Everything is fine. You're waking up. You've had an adventure.
Much worse than an adventure. Fire and children running. Terrible chaos outside. Was it a dream? Wide awake, she had been striding deep into the wood. Silence outside now. Then the mockingbird gargling. Dawn silvered the top of the windows back in the L. She did not recall a door. No opening, no exiting. Her head felt like a tunnel was blown clean through it. A slick cold clasped her arms. James's hand steadied her.
Hardly knows what's happening, James. My God, whispered Agnes.
I know perfectly, she began, but her tongue stopped, as if her mind filled with paste. James watched her, clearly a little disturbed.
Darling, we think it best that we keep this among us for now.
He touched her nose, then circled the kitchen with his index finger. Agnes, James, Hettienne. A finger to his lips. Sss. He sealed the circle shut.
Your mother hates it here enough already, Agnes whispered.
Now, in the daylight, in this warm kitchen with breakfast cleared, Hettienne shivered. Helen and Margaret closed in on their sister.
Agnes, you've been awfully quiet about all this, Margaret observed.
Never quiet, always at it, Helen quipped, glaring at her eldest sister.
Mop in the morning, woodsmen take warning. James was sleepless, I was sleepless.
Agnes pinched the air as if she meant to nip Helen and Margaret at their ears.
Why not get to work if all the lights are on in the head? Then, Hettienne, what's the meaning of this?
Asked Margaret. She stamped her foot, and pot lids shook.
Agnes and James are bumbling, and you're late to breakfast. Out with it!
Hettienne kept her mouth very full of melon balls. For the first time, it struck her why her father might have fled this place. Just as she was about to swallow, and those three long faces raised expectantly for her answers, a timid rapping startled the flock. Cousin David Ormond sidled into the kitchen from the L, a straw hat in his hands.
Aunties, he called, and the flock abandoned Hettienne. More tea, David? Sausage? Biscuits? Offered Margaret.
She arced like a bow on the tips of her toes, the biscuits on a green platter held high. Waxed paper trembling. David took a yellow biscuit in each fist and crammed them down in his overall pockets, waving off the fresh waxed paper thrust at him.
Thank you, thank you. I want to show Hettienne the raft I've built, for the fireworks tower. May I steal her? Is she excused?
The spinsters lifted her food right from her and retreated, yet with crafty sidelong glances they watched her as she followed Cousin David. When the two children were gone, Helen shared a long, dark look with Margaret.
Secret secrets, warned Helen.
Tss, Agnes hissed.
Chapter 4. They hurried for the lake before Johanna and the other Ormonds knew them to be gone. In a cove shaded by sycamores, hackberries, and flaky Red River birches, the original owners of the farm, the Headleys, had built a stone jetty. There, David made a worthless but valiant show of brushing off the mossy limestone so she could be seated. "Where's this raft?" she asked, looking all about. She could feel herself acting a part, grinning and breathless before him like lovesick girls at Our Lady of the Angels. Yet her head still felt hollow and windy from last night's episode or spell, whatever the family would be calling it. At least with Cousin David here, she felt the bright possibility of everything returning to summer again, becoming the Headley's Emerald Park again, what the farm had been called before the Sheehys had bought it, a place of old Springfield legend where the only dreams that came true arrived in the daylight and were never bad. David pointed to the shoreline. Down the shore, a raft of logs topped with planking bobbed where it was tied. "Why not build the raft next to where Uncle Simon started the tower?" The tower and raft both were for the fireworks extravaganza, the first in years, the war being won. The raft was to carry the tower, decked with pinwheels and Roman candles. All of it floated out onto Emerald Lake Park and lit during a planned storm of rockets. 5 long years of war, and no fireworks, and hardly any butter or sugar. But this summer, a bounty flooded them from stoked green hills. Now munitions factories were pumping out firecrackers instead of deadly arms. David's brow creased.
"Ever tried building something with your uncles?"
On David's face, the rounded high cheeks and narrow chin of the Ormonds were softened as if scrubbed by an eraser. He looked a little like his mother, Aunt Kate Sheehy Ormond, especially when he bowed his head and his brown bangs, which needed a cutting, fell forward. At the back of his hair, tight curls formed a ridge, and just now this fixed, oily patch glinted like the crown of a bronze helmet. "Must be some headache," she said. Could she still touch him? She wanted to touch his knee, his handsome, muscular legs packed in those overalls, the fabric stretched with him sitting Indian style. He was 3 years older than Hettienne, and this summer, more than any before, she desired his approval and affection. David paused.
"Hettienne," he asked, "can you tell me what's going on? Are you ill? Sheehys don't get ill unless they die. You aren't dying?"
Oh, how romantic that would be to tell him, "Yes. Yes, David, I am dying, and this is my last summer with you ever." What would he say then? Would he clutch her to him like a fallen dove? "Of course not. Don't be silly." She watched him, but with her head bowed. He seemed to be gulping at something. "That's propaganda anyway," she continued. "What the aunties say. Of course Sheehys get sick, but then they don't die every time. And of course most Sheehys are sick when they do die. We don't get hit by trains or smashed under tractors or fall from castle walls, at least not that often." Now he was watching her carefully. His eyes were his father's, who was not welcomed at the farm, whom Hettienne had only met at Mass at Sacred Heart, caramel, toffee brown, like a hickory leaf at the last of its turn in fall.
"So what was that at dinner yesterday?" David asked. "You had baby Liliana so worked up, she wouldn't nap."
At the water's edge in a meadow down the shore from them, a scissor-tailed flycatcher, yellow, gray, black of beak and tail, white of breast, hovered, flitting, as if standing on that impossibly long X-shaped tail. A miracle. She had never seen the birds, her talismans of July, anywhere but here in the Ozarks. "Do you promise to say nothing at all if I tell you? Not to your mother, most of all not to Johanna?" David shrugged.
"Sure. Yeah."
"Swear it," she said, sticking her pinky at him. He hesitated. Then he latched his pinky into hers. 3 summers ago, they had discovered Frank Headley Jr.'s diary in the barn loft. Frank Headley Jr. was the last of the Headleys who had built Emerald Park, now the old Sheehy place, into a showcase of a farm. The stone stables, the dirt oval horse track, the 40-acre lake, all things the Headleys had built. For holiday summer weekends and private soirees, the Headleys provided john boats and canoes for rent to flocks of townspeople. They had the waterfall improved with stone pathways. They renovated the property's original log home into a clubhouse for picnicking. Across meadows of dairy farm strolled prize Jersey cows churning out butter and Edam cheese and ice cream. They opened a winding cave, which thrill-seekers could travel seated in a string of refitted mine cars salvaged from one of the old Markin quarries. The whole train of adventurers tied to four Missouri mules. New mothers pressed postcards of Emerald Park into keepsake albums. Then, in 1923, the Sheehys came along, bought the whole thing, and shut it tight as a bank vault. Hettienne and David kept the diary secret, meeting on the sly at the Headley Spring House. In its foggy cool, under its alpine timbers, in its castle-like keep of limestone blocks that sweated shadows, they read the journal of Frank Headley Jr.'s last days at Emerald Park to each other. Cool kept potatoes, eggs and buckets of chili lime water, onions, beets, carrots, and cantaloupes stacked like ancient cannonballs at a battery surrounded them. The diary was tragic, even maudlin. Headley, who had farmed so well and built so much, with Percherons, Jersey cows, a cattery of Persians, a dynasty of running collie dogs, was forced to leave, and his heart was breaking because he was enough of a scientist to connect the seizing of his lungs with all the flying hair, pollen, feathers, dust, and ruckus of Emerald Park. He recorded his sadness in the plain, near-perfect block type of a draftsman. In the end, nurses packed him away. He left everything behind for the relief of a sterile desert, Arizona. To the baron and princess of this green, hilly kingdom, it was an unimaginable, unbearable fate. To live, he must give up all he had ever lived for. Shaking from more than the spring house chill, Hettienne read to David, "The land I have husbanded assaults me. The air, it kills me from the inside out, the outside in. My own country sickens me. It is as if I made manna of my own lands, with my own hands, manna in plenty. Yet when I broke it and gave it to the people of the Ozarks, it returned not a blessing, but a white and teeming curse." Speaking those words out loud seemed to send a rumbling shudder through the old stone springhouse. Astonished, they waited frozen in its shadowy clasp until finally Hettienne raised her pinky. In absolute silence, they swore an oath too weighty for spoken words. Together, they hid the crumbling leather binder and its ochre diary behind a loose stone with an odd Northern Irish name, Markin, chiseled into its facing, still legible but vanishing, chipped, and spotted green and yellow with age. Now, in the sparkling sunlight off the lake, Hettienne unwound her hair from the bun, her long white arms making two big L shapes. Watching his gaze, which did not seem much enraptured, she experimented and arched her back like the girls painted on bombers. But David's look remained as cool as a clinician's. "All right." At lunch, I sat down, and there was the empty plate and the salad fork with a cloud, a spot on it. And then I was elsewhere.
"Elsewhere? In your head, elsewhere? Like where? Chicago?"
David had long ago given up needling her as the only Sheehy who used the city term lunch. Hettienne shook her head. "Outside the house. But it was night. And there were people, all in black, wandering around."
"People? Who? Sheehys? Ormonds? Hobos? Thieves?"
"Savages. Barbarians. Some other people, not us, not family. One of them stuffed a closet with hay and set it on fire. Our house, Simon's house, Sheehy Mansion, on fire." He was quiet for a bit.
I don't get it. People from South Town? People from before Springfield? Like Osage Indians?
She slumped her shoulders and squinted. Long-haired, bearded, almost like a bunch of old-timey German soldiers went to sleep in their spiky leather clothes and helmets and woke up years and years later, dirty, with long beards. And the women, all their skin painted like sailors from Cuba.
Stuffing hay in all the closets?
No, that came later. And just one heathen, in one closet. But eventually everything was on fire, in ruins. Over the whole surface of the lake, diamonds of sunlight burned on the water, sending radiant warmth over them. And then, inside the house, lettering everywhere, on every wall and door. Not like warnings, but mad lettering. Nonsense, like idiots or cripples would write. "Evil awaits," she recalled, written in bold red paint at the base of the Headley stone silo. Some of this she knew had come to her during whatever had happened before she awoke in the kitchen in her chemise. Before her fit, all she remembered was the pain in her arms and legs. The moon, full and milky, filled her bedroom window. Then outside, the shadow of a huge bird. No, four of them in the trees. Four greasy blackbirds hunkered, sulking, ragged like sopping hobos. When they flew, their arched wings became curved sickles, the wing and the tail all one crescent swoop without distinctions, suspended in the air, making a rent silk of the moonlight. Then she was elsewhere. Then just as suddenly, James petted her shoulder, and she sat before a roaring stove in her nightclothes. David smiled, but the effort showed at the corners of his eyes. She thought for a moment, "Stop, stop, stop. This all should cease." He was an Ormond from the Ozarks, where nothing abnormal happened, everything proceeded in 4-4 time. This was not Chicago. There were no tramps wandering and mumbling, no tattered beggars outside Union Station, no veterans with wide, shattered eyes queued at the Salvation Army hostel, no Unionists agitating on Wacker, no sad ghosts gandering out the cyclops eye of the Blackstone. In the Ozarks, there weren't even any coloreds. "You think I'm crazy?" He raised his chin.
"You can't be. You're a Sheehy."
He bobbed his eyebrows. "That's not very funny at all." He did something he had not done since she was 8 or 9, and placed his hand over hers and drummed upon the lunate bone of her wrist the Morse code HES, Hettienne Ellery Sheehy, her initials. She began to cry, but without sobbing, without breathy weeping. He squeezed her hand and would not let go. "And then there were these sad kids with opal skin," she started again, recovering, "all moping about in black clothes and zany black hair, like creepy old Austrians from some haunted castle. And their music." She laughed and then pulled her hand from his to grind the tears into her cheeks with her palms. "Oh, what the devil is this all about, David? I don't understand any of it. And why me?" He did not turn away, but he did look her over anew from head to toe with a tenderness that one brings to a wounded pet.
"What was the music like?"
She tried to smile at him. "Awful. Like it was written and performed by people with the stomach flu. Like listening to a huge grandfather clock flying apart while some maniac wallops it with a cello. And fires. God, they lit fires all the time. Everything was trampled. Everything ruined. Everything broken. Everything burned." He looked down at the water.
"All this came to you at the dinner table?" You were quiet for just a minute or two.
She didn't want to lie to him. I don't know what more to say, David. I feel fantastic most of the time. But how are we supposed to know how we ought to feel when I don't get to feel like anybody else but me?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.